Hello there, warm welcome to Proactive London. Joining us from SHIELD Therapeutics today, it's the CEO, Greg Madison. Great to see you again, Greg.
Great, Katie. Thank you so much for your time and good to see you again as well.
Pleasure. So you recently updated the market on your progress in the US. So how is the launch progressing? Tell us all about it, Greg.
Yeah, so one thing that's very, very clear to us, you know, after these first several months is there is an absolute clear need for a well-tolerated and effective oral line out there. We have heard that consistently across the board from all of our physicians. I think in terms of launch progress, we've made significant progress, particularly if you think about it and you step back and consider the company made the decision to actually launch on its own in the US less than 10 months ago. Right. So you really started from almost a dead stop in terms of presence in the US and establishing a presence here and getting out and launching Accrufer. And the things we outlined, you know, when I joined the organization right on top of the launch in July, were three main criteria for us in the launch. One is we needed to increase awareness of Accrufer. Number two, we wanted to generate clinical experience from physicians through our patient assistance program. Number three, we wanted to establish payer coverage overall. So if you think about those three metrics and the progress we've made with each of those, from an awareness perspective at launch, the awareness of Accrufer was virtually zero, right? Nobody had really heard of Accrufer. There was no pre-market development. So we really needed to get that on the radar screen of US physicians. We have made very good progress in that regard. Recent market research indicates that we've doubled the awareness of physicians of Accrufer in just a 6-month period of time. So very good progress there. More room to go for sure, but very good progress. We've done a very good job of establishing a patient assistance program and generating clinical experience for the physicians. It's really important, you know, while we're building up our payer coverage, that we give patients and clinicians the ability to write prescriptions for Accrufer, get in the habit of writing, but get patients on the drug and actually generate some of that clinical experience. We've seen significant growth from the third quarter to the fourth quarter in terms of the overall number of prescriptions, and the feedback we're getting thus far is positive. And certainly last but not least is the payer side. As announced in late December, we announced four payer agreements that we went underneath with pharmacy benefit managers that gave us access to about 40 million lives overall, or 22% of the commercial market. We've actually made nice progress even in the first month of the year, with that now has increased from 40 million lives to 60 million lives. So I'd say across the board, you know, very good progress considering where we started from, you know, but obviously a lot more room to grow, and we intend to and plan to do a lot better.
Mm-hmm. And all of what you mentioned just there, we're going to break down now just in sections. And first of all, we just want to talk about the feedback that you mentioned there, and in regards to the US physicians and patients as well, what kind of feedback are you getting exactly?
Yeah, it's that part gives me a lot of encouragement, right? As I said in the very beginning, the general feedback we're getting, it is so clear that physicians are really looking for a well-tolerated and effective oral iron. And we think that's what we can deliver with Accrufer. You know, when our team is able to get in front of a doctor and talk to them about Accrufer overall, the reception is very, very positive right now. You know, recall that, you know, they hadn't heard of Accrufer before. So you have to kind of get in front of them again and again and again. They say in general, it takes, you know, 6, 7, 8 times for somebody to hear a message before it starts to kind of stick in. And again, they started from basically a zero level of awareness of Accrufer. That being said, when they see the product, they like the profile, they want to be able to use it. And the feedback we're getting anecdotally through physicians and from patients in terms of how the drug is working is very consistent with what we saw in the clinical trials. We don't really hear any kind of, you know, message coming back to us of tolerability related issues, which is important, or GI related adverse events. Not to say that they may not occur, but certainly if that was an issue, we would hear that pretty much right away from the launch perspective. You tend to hear some of the bad things first versus the good things on the back end, if you will. One last thing, Katie, is that we did recently an advisory board with several nurse practitioners and physician assistants, and their feedback during that, I listened into part of the advisory board. I mean, it just, again, you walk off that call and you're just so encouraged by what they say. They love the product. They acknowledge the issues that are out there. Their biggest question was, we haven't heard of this drug before. Where has this been? You know, now that we're of it, now we understand it, we want to learn more. And I think that's really what we're trying to grind through here, is that awareness piece, that interest, get them utilize the drug, and then start that build through adoption.
Mm-hmm. Greg, something else that you mentioned in your overview at the beginning was this reimbursement covering the 60 million insured lives. Do you expect revenues to increase significantly in 2022 as a consequence?
Yeah, I'm not going to comment necessarily on the revenue ramp and how that works, but it's an important point, Katie, you bring up here in terms of just, clarity. And I think, it's important people understand, we try to communicate this during the first 6 months launch that, until you build up your payer coverage, everything is going to flow through a patient assistance program whereby we're selling the drug to the patient at a very nominal cost, right? So, from a revenue perspective overall, that's very low, if any, revenue for us. But again, critically important to get patients on the drug and get physicians in the habit of writing the drug while you're building up your payer coverage. So the 60 million lives we start with, as of now, and we continue to build that throughout the year, is really important because instead of, say, the last 6 months where, if you imagine the number of prescriptions that come in, the high majority of those are patient assistance related prescriptions. Now we can start, taking part of those prescriptions and they'll be paid prescriptions, i.e. revenue producing prescriptions overall. Now, it doesn't mean that you've got physicians here in the US. It's not as simple as, hey, here's a doctor and they see all Express Scripts patients, for example, right? It's not the way it works, right? They see a variety of different patients with a variety of different plans. So our critical piece is, as I said before, raise awareness of Accrufer, get them to start writing the drug. Those patients that come in, we will start to see a larger percentage of those that are paid prescriptions versus patient assistance prescriptions. And again, that's going to build over time. So that doesn't happen at the flip of a switch. This is kind of more of a marathon versus a sprint, if I could use that analogy, but we'll start to see good progress. That's why it's also really important for us as we go through 2022 to continue to expand that payer coverage throughout the year.
Mm-hmm. So it's very much a long-term potential for Accrufer. Has your view kind of changed since you started SHIELD in June 2021?
Yeah, it's actually gotten, I'd say, more bullish, honestly, right? Despite the fact that, we started at a point where, there was, again, no awareness of Accrufer out there. We got a great product and the company was, just rushing very quickly to get the product out there and make it available for physicians, right? So, my viewpoint of the product from a clinical perspective, based on what I've seen and heard come back from physicians, I'm more bullish than ever. It's so clear. And I don't just speak for myself, like my team, my chief medical officer, our team here, we just hear that feedback come back and we can see the opportunity there in front of us, right? So then it's okay, how do we really capture that? I mentioned payer coverage is obviously an important component of that. The awareness piece is important as well. We just did a KOL event that's actually posted on our website for people to take a look at, recently with a US-based physician and a physician out of Germany as well. And the US-based physician, he's an OBGYN. He just articulated the problem so nicely and the fact that, look, this is a new solution to an old problem. We know that anemia exists. We know that the oral irons we find as clinicians that they're not fairly well tolerated. We love what Accrufer looks like. And if I have a choice, this is my first line agent overall, right? And you just hear that over and over. So, it's not as easy as, kind of just getting this message out there once and have everybody flip a switch and go. You've got to kind of figure out ways to kind of get back in front of them over and over again. And that's some of the things that we're working on now. But I am extremely bullish about the opportunity that's in front of us. It's really clear that there's a need for patients out there suffering from anemia to have a better, and more tolerated option.
And that's what it's all about at the end of the day.
It is, exactly. Yes, exactly.
The patient. Right. So for investors watching this, what are the areas of focus then for them to watch in 2022?
Yeah, I think as we go into 2022, right, some of the key priorities for us, will sound very similar to what we've been doing for the first 6 months, right? So first and foremost, I've mentioned a couple of times now, that awareness of Accrufer, right? So even though we've made very good progress overall, we've doubled the awareness, in the 6 months, we've certainly got more room to grow here, right? So that's an important element for us overall. I think that the second piece overall is we want to generate, not just clinical experience, but we want to start to do now is increase what we call the breadth and depth of prescribing, right? So what do I mean by that? So when I use the term breadth, it's how many writers can we get writing the drug? So this is really new writers, right? So, they become aware of Accrufer. What do we need to do to kind of get them to write that first or second prescription to start to try the drug? So that's our breadth component. How do we get more physicians writing it? The depth piece speaks to physicians that start to write it. How do we move them through the adoption scale, right? How do we get more prescriptions out of that one doctor? So moving from kind of a trialist, more towards that adoption scale. So those are two important elements for us overall. And the third, to echo what I said before, is the payer coverage, right? Great, great start, at the end of the year, good start to this year. We'll take advantage of those contracts we have, but we've got to continue to increase that payer coverage, and we fully expect that will be the case.
All right, Greg, thank you very much indeed from Shield Therapeutics here on Proactive this afternoon.
May I make one more comment, Katie?
Of course, please do so.
Yeah. So I think it's important to say that I think for all of our shareholders out there, like, we are extremely focused on getting this product out there in the hands of as many patients as possible, right? And while I mentioned the progress that we've made, we look at internally, we took to say the first 6 months, what's gone well, what hasn't gone well, and we certainly plan to, and we believe we can do better, right? And so a couple of those elements that we're talking about here are related to Salesforce effectiveness. I think it's important that internally, we've made some recent personnel changes to bring in additional talent into the organization. An important element of that, we've pulled in a new head of sales and new field management team that are now Shield employees. They were contract employees before, but they're now Shield employees. Mm-hmm. What I can tell you is they are extreme. I mean, you feel my passion, I hope, going through. Yeah. They're even more passionate than I am, right? They are excited. They want the opportunity. They want to get this product out there. And so as we think about our Salesforce effectiveness in terms of, efficient targeting, the right messaging, but also the right oversight, that's an example of some of the things that, we're not sitting back and waiting for things to happen. We're being very, very proactive here in terms of managing the business, updating our personnel and getting the right, things going on here. We're also exploring a lot of different ways to be efficient at getting that awareness out there. There's a lot more we can do on the digital side and the omni-channel side, and we're making plans right now from an infrastructure perspective to take advantage of that, which in the end of the day is a little bit more cost effective, in addition to what you have when your reps out there. So I think our underlying message here is that, while we've made progress, by no means we satisfied by any stretch of where we are. We believe and intend to do a lot better. And I think you'll see that as we go through 2022.
All right, Greg, I'm looking forward to catching up more on your progress there from Shield Therapeutics.
Great, Katie. Thank you for your time.